Hello and welcome to this course on quantum information processing. My name is Henning Schumerus. I'm a professor for theoretical physics here at Lancaster University, where I arrived in 2005, and I've taught this course on quantum information processing since 2009, so over 10 years now, but now for the very first time in a different setting. So welcome to my home. I hope you are sitting somewhere comfortable as well. In this very first video, I'm going to give you an overview of this course. I'm going to lay out the plan and give you an idea of what the goals and the aims and the goals and the structure of this course are. So quantum information processing is a wonderful subject. In general, it actually contains two important areas of applications, one of which is sending information from one place to another. That's quantum communication. And the other one is solving problems by looking at a certain set of data and trying to decide something interesting about it. And that's called computation. So quantum information processing is a broader term because it encompasses both of these aspects. And it uses some of the most intriguing features of quantum mechanics. So we are going to start by revisiting the foundations of quantum mechanics. I'm going to tell you what this entails in a second, but I'm first going through the list of main topics. Then we're going to have a quick look at the most basic concepts of classical computing. Then we're going to have a look how we can adapt these very basic concepts for quantum systems. And this is going to define the basic concepts of quantum information processing. Now, there are two big areas in which these ideas are being applied, and one of them is for communication and the other one is for computation. This defines two chapters in this course, which are really the core of it. So there is quantum communication and quantum computation. And finally, we are going to look at some of the practical issues to implement these concepts on physical platforms. Now, when we revisit the foundations in order to make this adaptable to the subject here, we are going to start from the main postulates. But now if we think about these physical devices, the strength of a computer is that it's a flexible arrangement of components that interact with each other. And if we want to do something very similar on a quantum level, we have to understand how quantum mechanics works for composed systems. So we are going to look at the postulates first on a very general level, but then we are going to adapt them and really focus on the aspects which are most relevant for composed systems. And for instance, one of the questions that you can have is that you have a complex quantum system, but you can only access information about one of its parts or some of its parts. So how do you actually describe such systems? And there is this concept of a density matrix. So we are going to discuss the concept of a density matrix that is exactly achieving this. And in exactly this context, we are going to encounter entanglement, which is really the key concept related to how different quantum systems made of different parts are interacting, and in particular, what sort of information they are sharing, which will turn out to be one of the main resources for a quantum computer. Okay, then when we look at classical computation, we're really focusing on the most basic concepts, and these are things like bits, gates, and ways in which we can actually quantify information on a classical level, which has a very nice and physical interpretation in terms of an entropy. So we are going to look at the link between information and entropy. Now this is actually going to be a very short chapter because these concepts fortunately are very fundamental. And similarly, when we then look at the basic concepts of quantum information processing, the main aim of that chapter will be simply to define what we mean by a quantum bit or a qubit, quantum versions of gates, And also very briefly, I'm going to talk about the quantum analogs of these entropies. In this chapter, we are already going to see how quantum mechanics actually makes it interesting to work with these objects. So you might have a situation in which one part of a composed system has a clear effect on another one, but in the quantum setting, it then suddenly might look like the role of these two parts is interchanged. So this is really like interchanging cause and effect, or even like ideas of causality, if you like. Okay, so now when we move on to quantum communication, we are going to look at some circuits. Circuits are compositions of gates which serve a certain purpose. And the first two circuits that we're going to look at are superdense coding. And quantum teleportation. And we are also going to look at quantum key distribution. This is simply the idea of having two people sharing a key so that one person can encrypt and another person can decrypt the message that they want to share securely. Okay, and then we are going to move on to quantum computation. And there we're going to have a look at a sequence of algorithms, first starting with the Deutsch algorithm, which is really the conceptually simplest algorithm in quantum computation. Then at the Grover algorithm for quantum searches, and the Shor algorithm for prime number factorization. So these are the three most important algorithms. The Shor algorithm in itself is built on a very specific circuit, which is carrying out something which is known as the quantum Fourier transformation, QFT. So this will be a central part of its discussion. When we then move on to the practical issues, we are going to look at errors in quantum systems. So actually, what can actually go wrong in a quantum computer is a little bit more intriguing than in a classical computer. First of all, we will have to understand the nature of errors in quantum computers, and then also how we can correct them. So we are going to look at error correction. Secondly, to bridge over to physical platforms, we are going to look at the so-called De Vincenzo criteria. Which simply codify the main requirements of a physical system so that it can serve as a platform for quantum information processing, be it for communication or for computing. In there, I'm also going to list a number of platforms, say quantum optical systems, condensed matter systems, and so forth, so that you get a good idea of which sort of physical systems can actually be used for this purpose, how precise can we build these systems, and what are the effects from the environment that can perturb these systems. So how can we best shield these systems from undesired effects from the environment and so forth. So this gives you an overview of this course. You get some insights into what we are going to cover and what you might take away from this course. I hope what you will take away is that you will develop a pretty good idea of what quantum information processing is really about, how a quantum computer, for instance, might actually work, getting a really good understanding of what quantum computing may be good for, what are the concepts on which it is built, and why people are interested in it. And I hope that you will share this interest at the end of this course. There are certainly many, many open questions in there. If you look into the practical implementations, just as much on a fundamental level, then people always come up with new ideas to use quantum mechanics in itself for quantum information processing. There are very deep theoretical questions and mathematical questions, and of course it goes up into the interpretation of quantum mechanics. Quantum information processing actually elevated the understanding of quantum mechanics itself to a very large extent. By looking at quantum information processing, you definitely develop a better understanding of quantum mechanics. And much of this is to do with its focus on questions such as entanglement, which before were maybe observations about the interpretation about quantum mechanics, but now they have taken a really practical relevance in this context. Now, it's, I have to say, so quantum information processing can be taught as an almost closed subject, which is actually really nice, in particular because the concepts are very clear. There are beautiful, complete solutions for interesting problems embedded in it. The concepts are extremely fascinating. But of course, it is also a very active area of research, and I hope that you will also see the links to the questions that you could ask beyond what is in this course. And I hope that you will be inspired to research this subject further. And you would be certainly very welcome to contribute to the progress of knowledge in this way. This gives you hopefully a good overview of what this course is about, and I hope that you will enjoy it. So what we are going to move on now is to the very first part of it, and there we are going to revisit the foundations of quantum mechanics.